SLG Hospitals is a 999-bedded, multi-super-speciality, tertiary and quaternary level care hospital, envisioned by philanthropist and entrepreneur Thandu Sivaramaraju and his family. Located in Bachupally, Hyderabad, SLG Hospital will be the first and only facility in the region to be constructed on the guidelines recommended by the Joint Commission International, JCI, a gold standard recognized worldwide for patient safety and quality of healthcare. The main strength of SLG Hospital lies in its seamless integration of clinical expertise, advanced technology, global standard practices, and compassionate patient care. Renowned physicians with experience from across the globe form the backbone of this institution that has been established to bring world-class healthcare within the reach of everyone.
Welcome to Hybris Conversations. My name is Suresh Kochatil. Running a hospitality chain is different. Running a healthcare facility is even different. But how are people straddling these two worlds? How do they combine the expertise of running one facility with another? Because both are different as chalk and cheese. But DBS Somaraju, Executive Director of SLG Hospitals, does both these roles with a great deal of panache. Today we have with him a conversation to discover his facility, that is SLG Hospitals in Hyderabad, and how the hospital is different from the run-of-the-mill facilities. Welcome to the show, sir.
Thank you.
So at the outset, let me start the conversation by asking you this very, very obvious question is, you started with the hospitality sector. So was that your first venture? Because you also were into agri and other divisions also. So can you just take us through your early days of your business?
So when in 99, when I came back from the US after my master's, we have a property in Somajiguda where my father wanted to build a hotel. So then based on his interest, when I did my master's in the US way back in 99, I have taken a special interest on the hospitality industry. So based on that, I started involving in the project after I came back and opened Katria Hotel in Hyderabad. So it is a 225-room hotel and with two restaurants and a bar and a banquet halls. So over a period of the time, we created a lot of trust with our brand and our services towards the hospitality industry. And later on our expansion plan to the next level, so we had acquired some land here. So we thought, this was 10 years back when we acquired this land, we thought we'll do a convention center kind of a thing. So then later when we frequently started visiting the property, then we felt there was a lot of need of a hospital here in this area. And in this area, there are around 35 lakh older people are there in and around of 10 kilometers radius. So when we did the market survey, then the market survey also says it is a fantastic location, being in a hub of a residential area. They said it's the best location, ideal location for a hospital. Then being a hotelier, we always feel like there is a lot of scope for a medical tourism which is coming up in India.
That's a big thing, yes.
In India. And in southern states, there is not much of that movement is happening except in Kerala and little bit of in Tamil Nadu. So, but if you go to the north and Bombay area, there's a lot of this medical tourism activities.
Middle Eastern
countries are all coming in. Then based on that, then again we had a survey of the location, how feasibility it is. This location is only 3 kilometers from the ORR. And from the airport, it's going to take 40 minutes on the ORR to come to this property. So this the size of the project is also then we decided yes, we have to do and we'll explore and we'll do the best, because we are from the hospitality industry, and being a hotelier, it is always we are always in good mood in hosting the guest, and
so we know how to please
the people.
That brings me to the next question: is hospital is a hospital.
Yeah,
I mean, I also worked for 10 years in the healthcare sector, apart from being in the hospitality sector and media. The question is that, you know, when you build a hospital, you really talked about medical tourism, which is still relatively untapped in India. Ayurveda has its own calling in Kerala. There's a lot of tourists to come there. Bombay, as you said, the Middle East tourists come. But when you talk of a hospital in a location like this, and when you put all the modern equipment, the best of the doctors, what difference will you say you are different from a hospital, say, 10 kilometers from here? How different are you? Is it the service? Is it the technology? Is it the doctors? What is making it a different place?
So, as you rightly asked, what is the difference between other hospitals and my hospital? And coming to that thing, number one, being a recent entity in this locality, and not only in this locality, in the Hyderabad, we managed to get the best of the equipments and which is the latest equipment. See, for example, if somebody had opened an oncology center 10 years back, the technology keep on changing every day. So, and in especially medical field, being so competitive, and for the who manufactures the medical equipments as well, they also have to change the technology very frequently to be in the market, to be a thing. So, for a medical thing, next any equipments what has been purchased, it will be good for 5 years
after
or 8 years. After that, it has to be replaced. So, getting into changing that equipment itself will cost more. So, compared to other medical centers in and around 10 kilometers, I proudly say we have the best of the equipments and best of the technology available. And our motive comes here by giving affordable healthcare for the people. So in market, why I am coming into that picture is, in 2006, my mother got little sick with some chest pain. So when we have taken her to the hospital, and they always, everybody confused us with two things, whether they said it is a malignancy or a TB. So we were very much confused how to get the treatment to the next level. So being in a Hyderabad and known to most of the doctors because of our existing business, and everybody was a little overexcited, and they wanted to do the best. In those that time, there was a lot of people who had given a conclusion of without having a proven test. They said we'll do
so
the surgery.
More of a guesswork than
we'll do a surgery, and then we'll take a biopsy there, and if it is proven, then we'll remove that. Otherwise, we'll give treatment.
So it's a malignant. We'll handle it.
We were very, very much confused, there was that time there was some more PET CT kind of introduction had happened. When we have done a PET CT, and one of the doctors said it is a stage 4, and they said, unless you do a treatment immediately, our lifespan is going to be only 1 month. So you take a decision. So in that situation, we have to give her a chemo dose 1. Okay. And as a son and my father, we felt very bad So are we have taken the right decision? So then we have taken her to Bombay Tata Memorial. As a common man, stood in the line, got the test done, and the doctor, they said, only after you receive the confirmation from the particular thing, then only we start the treatment. Then fortunately, we got the
reports,
and it happened to be a TB. But very unfortunately, we had given her a chemotherapy had given. So from that time, it's back of our mind, we have to do something for the society as well.
So that's the genesis of setting up this.
Yeah, that is one of the core reason for our heart to be in the project. Otherwise, everybody put money and take money.
So when you say affordable healthcare, there is always this debate in India, because a huge chunk of our population is below the poverty line. And they usually go to the primary health centers or in the villages. And in a state like Telangana, or for that matter, even Andhra Pradesh, because I come from Kerala, where the primary health care is very strong, not because of the present government or past government, but because from the 17th, 18th century, the Ayurveda was a big draw there, and they had created that facility. So when you say affordable health care, are there any reasons why you call it affordable?
Affordable health care in the sense our intention, what my father tells the doctors and everybody, he says not even one single blood test need to be done extra.
Unnecessarily.
So based on that, based on his philosophy, we are working towards that. So not that the moment patient comes,
you do all the tests
and even though few other places they already did the tests and still did not consider. So these kind of whatever is possibility of avoiding those things, because nowadays it's all becoming expensive. See, for example, if I want to get a CT or MRI done, we have invested 8 crores of rupees for MRI to be done. So there is a cost involvement is also there, I am not denying, and day-to-day expenditure also will be there. But once you create a trust with the patients, we are not doing unnecessarily. So once that comes, automatically things will happen and fall in the right place.
Yeah, because the argument that you rightly used, I mean, people say that we bought this equipment for 8 crores, so we need to run it almost 24 hours. So that the maximum number of tests can be done and amount can be recovered. Now, but on the other hand, we have people, and I have studied this extensively when I was in the healthcare, is that most of the rural bankruptcy happen because people sell off their property to take care of their healthcare whenever there's an emergency. Of course, now we have both the Arogya Shri in Telangana, we have the Prime Minister scheme going all over the country. So we have two different schemes that are there. But the question is affordability comes with insurance. And India, a culture of insurance is still catching up there. So the question is, when we talk of affordability, do you think people should take care of the health before it becomes bad? And this is that famous English saying there, a stitch in time saves nine. Most of the Indians don't do their health checks well in advance, and only the accident always happens to the other guy. Cancer never comes to me, it goes to the other guy. But when it comes to you, it hits you. So what's your philosophy on that line?
Actually, we encourage every year, at least once in a year, their health check has to be done. Because of that, we have tie up with all the surrounding residential areas. And we had given a lot of incentives to encourage them to become a member of us. So they will do a regular yearly annual health packages and all. And as you rightly said, insurance is the thing what most of the people are taking care. But problem with our insurance system is also because of the affordability of the clients again, they put a bracket of 3 lakhs or 5 lakhs or 10 lakhs. So depend upon their policy.
And then that budget overshoots.
That budget overshoots. So I always tell all our people is to be in that bracket only if unless it is a very very ill situation. So in that way they are trying to reduce the cost.
So when you say doctors, I mean they are the most important people. I mean of course your technical staff also is very important. Your support staff are equally important. We've seen in this COVID era, which nobody expected. Absolutely no. It is not a new virus, by the way. It's an old virus, the SARS variation. But nobody expected the kind of impact that it caused today across sectors. I mean, you name any sector, it's been impacted, from tourism to MSME to the hospitality to the healthcare. Everybody has been impacted in a big way. How has been your organization, the SLG Hospitals, in the forefront of tackling this particular COVID-19? What are the steps that you have taken?
So, for COVID-19 protocol, WHO and the central government had issued certain guidelines. So, by following that guidelines, all the treatments are happening in our hospital. So, for the COVID also, we have a separate block where the entrance is also different, the exit is also different. Doctors are also different. We had identified a separate team of doctors, separate team of nurses, separate team of other technicians who are supportive staff, including F&B service, everybody. And they work on 15 days, and 15 days they go as a quarantine. So in that way, we are well equipped, and we in fact today only just we started taking COVID patients. Okay. Because all these days government was also very not clear whether private organizations should take it or not. And few unexpected patients who were entered into the hospitals was closed for some time and making as a disinfection for 1 week, 10 days, and again reopening. Because of that uncertainty, we also did not take. But from today, we have started taking COVID
patients. You talk of your advanced equipment, you talk of your 64 slides, or you talk about your MRI or other equipment that are there. You said you bought the top of the line stuff. Obviously, there would have been GE and others who would have got involved in this. So can you take us through a few of those highlights of the equipment that you have here that makes this hospital, SLG, different from, because you talked, you're the latest entrant, and always the advantage of a latest entrant is that you get the latest equipment also. So can you talk us through that brief about each of those equipments?
So few equipments I'll be ready in, will tell you, which are basic requirement for any hospital to run in a smooth manner, which is an MRI, which is a CT, and a cath lab, and the monitors and stuff like that. So which are basic things which is required to run any small nursing home to a big hospital. So here we have 128 slide CT we have. We have 3 Tesla MRI with a wide bore. Then we have a very advanced cath lab. So I can show you.
Yeah, surely we'll go around it.
Yeah, so I can show you and explain the thing.
We are in radiation oncology department, where we have this machine called Elekta Infinity. We have imported from Germany, and where it gives a minute treatment for smallest tumor, 0.3 mm size. So it is very advanced machine, where the radiation levels are also very very minimal. So the patients who are coming and afraid of big radiation, this is one of the best equipment available for the lesser radiation. Thank you. We are at our CT. This is 128 slate CT. We have imported from America, and this can do a very less radiation compared to very other machines in and around our area. Approximately difference will be between 50% to 60% difference will be there compared to other radiation. The purpose of taking this machine is we have advanced radiation center. So patients frequently, for cancer patients and all, they do need to take regular CTs. So to reduce the pressure on the patient, we have selected this kind of high-end equipment. Thank you. This is our 3 Tesla MRI machine, where we have a wide board, and we have imported this from US, and very advanced mission. In this mission, it is anyway patient, most of the patients will be around 45 minutes in this mission. So if you can see the ambience also we have created, so the patient will be having a soother experience. And we also have a facility like watching TV inside, where the glasses has been given, three-dimensional glasses. The TV can be watched, the music can be, whatever is like of the music can be heard, and very advanced mission where we can diagnose the maximum cases for brain or joints or you name it, we have a solution for this. Thank you. We are at our cath lab. This is very advanced cath lab which we imported from again USA. And up to TAVI, all angiograms and all can be taken care of. Thank you. We are at our operation theatres, which are all modular operation theatres and well lidded with good space, where a lot of complicated surgeries can be taken care. And we have imported these lights from Germany, and we have imported these beds from Hong Kong. And we had created this wonderful ambience of operation theatres, where very, very complicated surgeries had happened, where we are all very well equipped. A few examples I'll tell you. If I talk about neurology, a neurosurgery should happen. Here we have neuro navigation, we have where spine can be taken care, brain can be taken care. Inter-operation monitor we have a CUSA, we have a microscope. All these equipments gives lot of imminent, less pressure on the patient, more better result, and the patient can recover much faster by using this all these latest equipments. And the complicated surgeries which are happened in neurosurgery, we can take care of trauma, we can take care of any kind of brain strokes, you name neuro and spine, we are equipped to handle any kind of thing. If I talk about cardiac surgery, where one example I'll give you, we have handled a case where that age of a person is 79 years and he is an obese patient, 120 kgs weight, and he went through many hospitals in Andhra and in Hyderabad, but nobody was ready to take his case because it was a very complicated case. And we have done it successfully, and the patient was normal within 7 days. So these kind of many cases, see, for example, if I talk about gynecology, our doctors had handled a case. The patient had a very rare group. That blood was not available, so the blood was very minimal blood was used to do the surgery. And if you talk about plastic surgery, there was a case where we handled the patient was 65% burned. After burning, that patient was a pregnant lady, and our gynecology team, our plastic surgery team, all are involved, and they have done extremely well. After 2 months, the patient came back again, given a baby with weight of 3.5 kg. So these kind of success stories are many in our operation theatres. If I talk about one more tumor case, where our oncology surgeons, plastic surgeon, and neurosurgeon and all are involved. There was a tumor, big tumor of almost 1.5 kg tumor, and it was stuck, and we handled that case very well, and that patient is normal now. These kind of stories, you talk about gynecology, we have a beautiful story to tell. Success story, not beautiful story, success story has been done. We have neurosurgery like that. You talk about cardiac surgery, we have best of the cardiac team available. And if you talk about emergencies, all these major things comes from emergency. Our emergency team is well equipped. We have biggest triage area with 25 beds available, with well-trained doctors, well-trained nurses, and we can do any kind of complicated cases, and most of the doctors are available 24/7 wherever is the emergencies. Thank you.
The reason, see, for example, when it comes to the CT and the MRI, for a neurology patients, it is any brain strokes or anything, these are very base requirements to be done a MRI. See, when they do an MRI, the advantages of having a bigger, a wider mission is the detailing of your brain goes into in depth it will go. So the decision of the clinician also makes easy to do what kind of treatment can be done.
So the detailing in terms of, you know, you can, when you do an MRI, it basically reaches out into the last part of your body.
Yeah.
Also, and gives you that much of detail to the doctor.
When it is a 3 Tesla, it is much advanced. So the decision power and advice what the doctor can be given, which will be the much faster. See, for example, there is other centers which are around this hospital may have a 16 slice, may have a 68 slice. There is an edge if they come to our hospital, there is an edge of having a latest test done here. And similarly with CT. So we have 128 slice CT, so which gives a very less radiation and more result. The scan also is very, very clear.
So Mr. Raju, the most obvious temptation, in fact, that's a question I asked when I saw the building. I said, the most obvious temptation would be to start a medical college, because with this kind of facility, when you have almost close to 1,000 rooms and you have such a huge facility, there's lots of land. Did this thought ever occur at the back of your mind that one day you should have a medical college?
Yes, we will be having a medical college. We have acquired some land here, around 20 acres, 2.5 kilometers from here. So in future, we'll definitely, but first of all, we also need to understand the business. Being a hotelier, hoteliers are always perfectionists, because you're also coming from the hotel background.
Correct.
So we try to be a little more pussier than the normal.
You want to get it right always. Because that, so the why I asked you the question was today, because when you look at today's COVID scenario, and you, I think right at that moment, you were here just started a year ago, and am I right? And then,
yeah,
you know, you're just
7-8 months old.
Yeah, you're learning the baby steps right now. So when you talked about that, you are rightly pushed into the action straight away. It is, as they call it, baptism by fire. So when you are put your medical staff through such a scenario, at the back of your mind, being a hotelier, there are two things that must be working. I should get it right, and I should get it right each time, because in the hotel, that is a basic rule that, you know, you can, the guest is always good.
Yes.
So when you compare these two worlds of the hospitality and the healthcare sector, how different are they?
It's a really tough question you asked, and the simple way I'll tell you. In the hotel, they'll come for doing a celebration and for relaxation. Here they come with a pain. So, but when the patient is going out with the satisfaction,
with a smile,
the smile what you get, I still am getting goosebumps. See, one day I was on my rounds, in the initial stages. So my ICU doctor introduced me to one patient. He said, our first ventilator was on him only. So then that person started crying and touching her feet. Madam, you saved my life. So what kind of satisfaction in how many things what you do, you get that kind of satisfaction. And obviously there will be unexpected things are also happen sometimes. But we try to minimize that and do best whatever could be done. Because as you rightly says, in a hotelier, we always say we cannot satisfy 100% everybody. And especially in this field, if you take an opinion from two doctors, it will be different. Same like in our kitchen, if two cooks makes, Even though we follow the recipe, the taste will be different. So,
in a healthcare sector, and having, again, as I said, I worked for a decade there, or usually a standalone hospital always tries to start a different set of hospitals in other areas because you need to interlink with the other areas also. So, suppose you are here and you need some facility, say 25-30 kilometers from here. Once you kind of stabilize this facility and you get it up and running, you acquire that knowledge to get it. Do you plan tomorrow, maybe not just in Hyderabad, but in other cities, do you plan to expand your hospital group?
So, obviously, we do require the filler places they call in business, especially for the hospitals. And definitely, we'll be acquiring the nursing homes or reasonable 150 beds setups in
satellite
centers we do. And we also, in future, we also have a plan of doing clinics all over the place. So, to make sure we reach, our reach is more.
In a healthcare sector, and like in the hospitality, again, I think we are drawing parallels here everywhere. The most important people are the people. Okay, they make a difference. Machines are there in the hotel. Their machines are there in the hospital. But it is that person behind the machine who makes the difference. How do you keep your staff motivated? Because that's the most difficult thing that any chief executive will tell you, that it's difficult to keep people motivated all the time unless you are a man manager. How different is your approach?
See, sir, when it comes to the handling the manpower, as we are in the business for quite a long time, and identifying a wrong person in the group is much easier than having a good team. So we always believe when we open, these kind of things will be there. What will happen when we open? We recruited around 400 medical nurses, paramedical staff, and all. And there are around 110 doctors we have recruited. In that that process, when we are in hurry of doing things and achieving the target dates, so obviously there will be one or two people will be joining. The wrong people will be joining. So those people has to be like, if you say you have a green grass, if something wrong comes up, you should remove it, take it off. So that is the first step to be having a good, strong team, what we believe in. And the second thing is, you, as you are in the hotel industry, you always feel guest is always right. So we also should treat our staff or the doctors and supporting staff, they're also always right. So we have to pamper them from the side and we have to manage the things. To reduce that, we actually started giving a lot of training programs for them. So how do they move in front of the patient? What are the frequent questions they need to ask at the time of coming? Even doctor also have to introduce himself and saying that he has to patiently listen what the problem the patient is facing. So as long as you do that, and when the patient is clear, whatever he is facing has been explained to the doctor, and doctor take proper notes of that, and then he will write required examinations what need to be done. After the examination, it is easier to take a decision what kind of treatment they have to go. So we do follow a lot of regulations because maybe 1.5 years down the line we'll be going for a JCA accreditation. For JCA accreditation, we need to have follow the maximum process. Protocols.
Yes, correct.
So if we simply follow that protocol, that itself is covers of maximum of everything.
Today, I remember when I was in a previous organization where a lot of technology was used. At that time, telemedicine was a big subject, but people are very scared of using telemedicine. They wanted to come and see a doctor in flesh and blood, somebody who wears a white coat, somebody who touches them, prescribes a medicine. So that was, it was not complete till the entire cycle was done. But today, in a COVID scenario, even a post-COVID scenario, because everybody said there was a, you know, before Corona and an after Corona era is there. In an after Corona era, how much of technology, I'm not talking of machines as such, but in terms of even consultation, how much of telemedicine, how much of remote healthcare is going to happen in your hospital?
So in our hospital also, we are doing a telemedicine. It is not a correct word to use as a telemedicine. Telemedicine is a different, doctor consultancy is a different.
Correct.
So unless that is clear, see, just because of the COVID, we are encouraging patients to consult doctor
online.
But there is always, doctor has to touch the patient's hand and see his pulse. That feel is there and it will be there. And for a second time consultation, it is easier to do it from home. But what the problem exactly is facing is just because of the COVID, we are encouraging people to do a telemedicine. Otherwise, it is always better to have first-hand kind of information.
An OP too.
OP. Unless the OP and the doctor sees, the confidence level of the patient also should happen. In over a phone, over telling, maybe line might not be clear. There might be, the face of the patient might not be visible properly. The expression, what kind of feel he is going through, what kind of pain he is going through, it is a little difficult. But it is in thing, we have to follow. Everybody has.
Mr. Raju, you are located in an area where there are a lot of residential colonies around. There are gated community. There are apartments, and a lot of them have elderly people, fathers and mothers staying there, and their sons and daughters are abroad. I mean, this is concept of home care that is coming big time. Because you're located so close to the residential area and you also have a hospital to fall back on, do you think the concept of home care also will be there sooner or later in SLG?
Of course, it will be there. It will be there because end of the day, when we enter into a medical segment, the home care is also required, nursing services at home is also required. So all kind of this thing also has to be used, and home delivery of the lab tests and all, and also pharmacy home deliveries also, it will be part of it.
What about the affiliations that you are drawing in from different institutions? Because today, knowledge, if bottled up, does not actually multiply. Knowledge has to be shared. So when you're talking of international arrangements that you're making, are there any such alliances in the pipeline?
So as I told you, ours is going to be a medical tourism project. We have a 120 room boutique hotel also is coming up.
Okay, I wanted to ask you that question actually. Why a boutique hotel?
So our main interest is also into medical tourism. So obviously we will be having tie-ups with international medical schools as international hospitals in various countries, and we do cater to that. And we have provided a helipad also.
Okay, and emergency evacuation.
And people who are coming from abroad, they can be airlifted from the airport to the hospital. And we are also equipped for transplantation. In that time also, helipads and all will be very, very critical and helpful. And the access also we had given directly to the operation theatres for these air ambulances.
So you're saying your dad is 90% visionary and you are the 10% visionary. So his contributions also match like that. But can you talk something more about your dad? I mean, what background does he come from and how did he get into this entire hospitality business as such?
So coming to my father, his name is Shivaram Rajagaru. So he hails from an agriculture family. When we came to Hyderabad, this was in 1979. So he started doing a contract, small contracts where he built Usmania Medical College, hostel buildings and mint compound. And then he had also built Prithvi Godowns. And he also built Food Corporation of India Godowns in Nalgonda and Hanuman Junction. And he also built HMDA colonies in Hyderabad and Nizamabad. And he also built Navodaya Vidyalaya schools in Karimnagar. So these kind of things, he's himself as a contractor, and that's how he entered into Hyderabad, and it's a long journey for him. So he's a more advanced thinking what is going to be happen and how
it visionary is that way, you know.
In that way. So when we casually sit and talk, the ideas what he gets, he's always inspiration for me and my sister and my elder son, because he's just doing his undergrad. So for all of us, he's a leader for us. So without him, we are nothing.
Okay. So the end of the day, when you're talking of yourself as a professional who moved, I wouldn't say moved, you are still there in the hospitality sector and to the healthcare sector. When you're talking of what are the final thing that you would like to be known as, when somebody says, oh, he created this institution, what is the one or two sentences you would say that you should like be known as? Mr. Raju was this, Mr. Raju was that. So how would you like to
be known? So in this segment, 90% credit goes to my father, so only 10% comes to end of the day, ours will be one of the most talked hospitality company in the country. So if we talk about hospital or a hotel, the services are the same, and end of the day, we are in the same industry.
Service industry. Thank you, Mr. Divyesh Raju, for speaking to us at Hybis Conversations. I mean, it's wonderful to see a passion that starts with the hospitality sector and comes and ends in the healthcare side. Very few people traverse both the worlds. Ladies and gentlemen, that was Divyesh Somaraju, Executive Director of SLG Hospitals, talking about his journey from the world of hospitality to the world of healthcare, and how he plans to build a world-class institution here in Hyderabad. Thank you for watching.